Can you talk about what it means for you to be part of this festival, this celebration of independent cinema?
Well, you know, I'd always wanted to come to Raindance, and so this is my chance. I'm working in Reykjavik. I'm just here for the night, but I'm happy to be here.
And I know it's a big question, but why does independent cinema, independent storytelling matter so much? What do you think it gives both an audience and a storyteller that they perhaps don't get from other forms of cinema?
You know, I feel like that basically Hollywood and larger budget movies don't always deal with the subjects that independent film strives to and loves to deal with. I think that when I was growing up, there were a lot of smaller budget Hollywood films and medium budget Hollywood films which dealt with life and issues and were less about gunplay and kind of production. So I feel like independent films really swept in to fill that gap of storytelling.
And in terms of this particular story, can you talk a little bit about some of the themes it does explore and what it was as a storyteller that most caught your imagination about that?
Indeed. I feel like The Roving Woman deals with our modern disease of loneliness in a way that's pretty singular. I haven't seen this before or anything quite like this. It's an incredible performance by Lena Gora, a very brave performance. I watched the film and was haunted by it. It's a hard subject, but I feel like it's something that we need to talk about.
And in terms of your place in that story, can you talk a little bit about your character and again what it was about the role, not just the project as a whole, that most spoke to you, that most made you want to be a part of it?
Yes. I don't know if I should tell the story this way, but I fought kind of not to be in the film in a strange way. I just hadn't worked in a while. It was COVID. It was, you know, 2 months into COVID and not much was going on. And they had asked me to be part of it, Michal and Lena, and I offered music and they said, great. So I would go to where they were staying every couple nights and play songs for them. And eventually they chose a song. And I thought that would be the end of my participation. And then Lena sent me a 2-minute clip of what they'd been working on, and it was really phenomenal little piece, and I thought I should be part of this. As far as the theme of the film and loneliness, the character I play, Gregory Malloy, is another lonely person in a sea of lonely people, trying to connect, trying to find purpose. You know, I've done a lot of films that really had no money, and this falls in that range. You know, it has really wonderful executive producers, Orion Williams and Wim Wenders, who came in, you know, once they'd seen the film and offered their help. This movie was made in a little vacuum, you know, with not a dime to its name. And I don't know. That's some of our best stories, I think, start that way, without an eye toward any kind of commercial reward. They just were making this film, and I hopped on board at the end, and I'm glad I did.
Can you talk about your experience working with this amazing man behind the camera, and then also a producer in Wim Wenders, who, you know, it goes without saying, one of the great storytellers of our generation?
Indeed. I'm thrilled to be part of something that Wim has put his name on. Michal is a young filmmaker, but I felt really in very good hands with him. That's not always the case when you tell a story, but in this case, he was assured and open to ideas. And again, it was such almost a neighborhood movie. I didn't know that it'd be at festivals and be in theaters or that I'd be talking to you. So it's all a great surprise. But I have a lot of love for Michal and his work and for Lena, and I'm anxious to see what else they do in this world, how they connect.
We're at a festival that above all celebrates the power, the magic of storytelling. I know it's a big question, but what does it mean for you to be a storyteller, and why do you think that telling stories matter so much in all our lives?
On a personal level, I don't know that I could live without being part of stories, telling stories. I love books probably more than almost anything, but cinema is right up there. All art speaks to me. I'm sorry I forgot the first part of your question, but
I guess just what it means to be a storyteller, to have that label, that mantle of responsibility.
Yes. I feel like like everyone on the planet, I want to connect with people. And the way that I connect best, I think, is by telling stories. And hopefully the work that I'm part of makes people feel less alone, makes people see themselves in pieces of it, and hopefully brings them some joy. I think that the art that I love is less geared toward guessing what an audience might want. So in a selfish way, I want to be pleased with what I'm part of. But I also am aware that there's an audience that we're aiming for in the end, that we hope will see our work. So it's always fun to sit in a theater and watch something you've been part of with a group. So I'm excited.
Is there one piece of work that you're most proud of when you look at your incredible back catalogue? You know, these films that have won you awards glory or just meant the most to you as a storyteller. Is there a particular piece of work you're most proud of?
Wow. Well, you could ask me again in 5 minutes what I'm proud of, and it would be maybe a different list. But I've been lucky enough to work with so many amazing directors and actors and artists that make these movies. I don't know, Winter's Bone comes to mind because Deborah Granick's a phenomenal director. It was a very singular experience. But, I've been so lucky. There's 20 things that I'm proud of and another maybe 200 things I'm not as proud of. But if I had time, I'd list them all. I'm currently in Reykjavik, Iceland, shooting the fourth season of True Detective with an amazing creator, writer, director named Isa Lopez, and just getting started on that. I'm really excited about it. It's such a phenomenal script. It's a rare thing. It'll be a 6-part series, and I've got a really cool role, so I'm excited to be part of it.
I mean, each season of True Detective has been phenomenal, but it's had its own very distinctive character. I mean, just overall, what do you think, is unique about this iteration of that show?
I think what's unique about this iteration of True Detective is that it's women-driven. It takes the male detective story and replaces it with two women. Jodie Foster and Kaylee Reese are the two leads. And, it's really cool. I think people will be pretty stunned by it. I hope so. When I read it, I was really blown away. It's a unique, wonderful, wonderful piece of writing, and hopefully we're bringing it to life well.
I mean, you mentioned Jodie there, one of the finest actresses of all time. What can we specifically expect from this performance? Because obviously she's a rare but very grateful presence in front of our cameras these days.
Yeah, I expect Jodie to just slay the world like she always does. It's a really difficult role, but I feel like, in the short time we've worked together on it, she's there. She's going to bring us something really special that I don't think we've seen her do before.
It's probably a little unfair, but can you tell us anything about your place in that world, the character, what it was excited you about your part in True Detective?
Yeah, I think I rub against Jodie's character in a good way. I play a character named Hank. I don't know what I'm allowed to say by HBO. But I don't want to say the antagonist, but I don't want to give anything away, but certainly I'm playing a complicated man, a misunderstood man.